So, yes, welcome to today's afternoon session. My name is Oliver Chulo. I was introduced yesterday without being here, I'm afraid. I was still sort of on the way back from my holiday. I'm a professor of translation in translation studies at the University of Leipzig, and one of my research topics is translation technologies. Mainly though from the viewpoint of the translator. So even though I didn't start out as a computational linguist, I studied computational linguistics, but I slowly went into the topic of translation and started looking at technologies from the viewpoint of translators and translation theory. I think that maybe because at some point I noticed that yes, technologies will evolve, that I should not be concerned about, or we should not be concerned about. Technology sort of is happening and evolving, but the question always is, how do we deal with technology? How does it change the way we work, live, and so on and so forth? How should we use it sensibly? Post-editing is such a point of convergence between humans and technology, right? The machine and the humans meet at this point of post-editing. I have to deal as a translator with something that a machine has produced. Is that in any way different? Or is it the same as before, just with some sort of new packaging? Does it change the way we work and so on and so forth? That is a huge question. We're going to look into one aspect, into one little aspect of the whole thing, and that is, as the title of this section says, ensuring quality in post-editing. Ensuring has a lot of implications or a lot of things that are linked to it. If you want to ensure quality, you have to for instance, you have to set up quality measurement, some sort of quality measurement, quality assessment, so that you can actually know what you want to ensure, right? What is quality? So, having asked that question, I would like to pass it on to you. What is actually quality? How would you define quality? Not quality in translation, but quality in general. What do you think is quality?
Fulfilling some standards.
Sorry?
Fulfilling some standards.
Okay, you were too quick. Where did you learn that? That's good. It's great to hear that. Because usually when I ask students, they're not so quick to find the right reply. In everyday talk, when we say quality, we mean things that are good, right? But what does good mean? And it is exactly what you said you have, and that is defined by the general literature and quality, also by the ISO 9000 standards, that quality is about fulfilling certain expectations that have been, well, probably agreed on in some way. Between you and the customer, or the institution you're working for. So it's about fulfilling expectations. Usually when we talk about quality in translation, or when at least from the type of translation teaching that I remember, we have very high standards, right? We want things to be, you said, fluent, adequate. That's MT terminology. We want the translation to be correct, to fulfill the function that it has been intended for, to address the audience properly, and so on and so forth. So you can have a long list of expectations or of standards that should be met. At some point in this lecture, we will get to a point where we will have to raise the question again, what are the expectations actually And we will see that with the advent of post-editing, these things have changed a little. But let's talk about post-editing first. So, Vato has already given a little introduction to post-editing. Now, what is the definition of post-editing? There are various definitions around. The most basic definition is the correction of raw machine translation output. There is one definition, one very interesting one by Sharon O'Brien in the 2011 paper, where she says post-editing, I'm citing this sort of off the top of my head, is probably not the exact wording. Post-editing is a correction of raw machine translation output by human translators according to certain criteria. And I think she also included, and according to guidelines, to post-editing guidelines. Why would we need post-editing guidelines? Shouldn't we all know what a good post-edited text is? Shouldn't it just be as a translation that we make? Well, we'll talk about that later. How does post-editing happen? How do you think people are post-editing? What do you have in front of you?
Depends, it can be a full text, it can be only a segment.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So we have full texts. We have segments. What do you mean by segments?
This would be like a sentence, let's say.
Could it be smaller than that?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes. And what do we see when we post-edit it? Sorry?
You could see a source and a target.
Uh-huh. But also?
Overcurrent.
Mm-hmm. I'm not aware of any terminological distinction between this, but that is pretty unusual already. Right? Usually when we think of translation is we get a whole text or a document or whatever and we translate that. Technology permits to sort of just feed little segments to someone. For instance, also when you translate, when you do localization of software, right? Sometimes you just have that one word which is there in the menu and then you have to translate that sensibly somehow. But I don't think this is distinguished at all terminologically, but there are at least two modes of post-editing that depend on whether you have the source text available or not. So the standard setting, I would think, is that you have a source text, and people just usually say post-editing to this. I don't think that there is anything like bilingual post-editing as a term. But there are settings in which you're only presented with the target with the raw machine translation output, and there is no source text that is delivered to you, and that is then called monolingual post-editing. Is it sensible, isn't it? Well, I would say it is not. For various obvious reasons. If there are any semantic errors that were introduced by the machine translation, then you cannot correct them because you have no source that you can refer to and check what the intended meaning was. But I've been told that there are studies on how well people deal with monolingual post-editing, what typical errors are that are being made in monolingual post-editing, and how that compares to the normal human post-editing. And apparently there are people in the industry, so not in the language industry, but in industry in general, who believe that Monolingual pulse editing can be done, and it can also be done by people that speak that target language more or less pretty well, right? Because everything's there, you know, the machine has done everything, and well, you just need to know French well enough, and you can correct the output that is there. Why am I bringing this up? Because when we talk about quality, or ensuring post-editing quality, we can refer to different levels of our workflow. We have the macro level, so we can try to ensure that the whole pipeline, that whole translation pipeline, adheres to certain standards that will ensure that the best quality comes out. Or we can zoom into the micro level and try to look at what the individual is doing in their post editing, and how we can ensure that this person will come up with the best result possible. So let's look at the post editing at a very, very rough and abstract schematic of the post editing process. So the standard process of translation is you have a source text, then you have a draft translation, you get a draft, there is a revision phase, that is probably a little shorter, well, should be. And then you get the target text, right? So, when you plug machine translation in here, now here's a question, right? Bartel said something about pre-editing yesterday. I'll make that optional here, because I'm not sure it even happens very much. MT is pretty quick, right? MT does not start calling people back to ask, what did you mean by that? Or is that the correct term? Or what does that term mean? MT will just try to do whatever it does, right? Then you have the draft, and then ideally, post-editing will be quicker than the revision. The main reason why post-editing is being done, or why it's even been considered, is that post-editing should save time. It should be at least more time efficient. Now, I mentioned monolingual post-editing, because, as I said, if you want to ensure quality, you can do it on a macro level or on a micro level and on a macro level. So on the level of the whole workflow, there are already a couple of decisions to be made. One decision is, for instance, for the type of post-editing. And for various reasons, as I said, there is at least a little bit of literature on that. For various reasons, you should probably go for bilingual post-editing, right? So do present people with the source text if possible. There are also questions like Bartel said yesterday, do I want to have a pre-editing? I think this is really an optional step depending on various factors. I mean, if you're a social media manager and you have to, for your team, right, you're a multilingual team and you're monitoring some social media streams and you have those tweets, right, or some short Facebook comments or whatever, and you want to have them translated for whatever reason, then you will probably not want to do a pre-editing at all, right? You would actually take away something. But if you have a technical documentation, then there are great tools that will help you do things like detect potential syntactic ambiguities or variation in your terminology. Some of them are even so good that they will not only give you a sign if you've used the dispreferred variant of a term, but maybe even a paraphrase, right? If you speak of minimization of costs instead of cost reduction, right? There are systems that are as good as that. Or if you say, I want to minimize costs, and then it'll flash and tell you, this should be cost reduction, right? It doesn't work very well for English, that example, but for German it works very well. So, as I said, there are a number of decisions that have to be made here at this point. Some factors which have already been mentioned throughout the first lectures, also, of course, about the type of MT system that you want to use. You'll want to use one that has been adapted to the domain. You might want to think about data security and so on and so forth, which is not exactly about post-editing, the latter one about post-editing quality, but just as a general remark. So, that is about... Oh, no, sorry, I forgot one thing. That is about the... just try to imagine this is all back here. And there is an additional step that you might want to introduce here. What is that? So you've post-edited your texts.
Yes.
Feedback. Feedback of any kind, right? And here is a huge problem that we will get to. It's a huge problem in general for text production tasks or for translation tasks, right? What are exactly the criteria by which you decide on how good your post edit was? How do you evaluate that? Somebody said something about fulfilling standards. I uploaded into the Moodle a document by Taos, and I keep forgetting what the name is. It's basically they call themselves a think tank for... Translation Automation User Society. And they call themselves a think tank, so they have very good resources on current developments in translation technologies. And I uploaded one of their more recent documents on post-editing guidelines to the Moodle, and what you will read there, what you will find there, is that there might be some general, very general principles of how you can do this quality assessment of your post-edits, but they always have to be tailored to your very specific use case. And then you can give feedback, and that is the interesting bit, not only to the people who work there, right? Here in the standard setting, you have a group of translators and you give feedback to your translators, right? But you can also include a step in which you give feedback to your engineers, to the engineers of your machine translation system. If you have people that are trained well enough in the topic of machine translation to, well, there are two ways to do this. Either you have a very good classification of errors here at this point, so you can pinpoint which errors the machine translation made, and you have a classification that is human usable, right? So that you can easily say, okay, I found this error here and there. Or, of course, you educate your people to a level in which they understand basic principles of machine translation well enough to be able to give a feedback to the machine translation engineers. So, any questions as up to here, or comments maybe from practice? Yes?
Feedback is just to provide a translated text to the engineers, which would then automatically improve their engines based on what is actually about the text that's actually being translated.
Yeah, that is correct. There is another type of, so you may remember the Martin Folk's slide on, you know, the number of edits in certain post-editing certain text types, right? No, certain types of subtitles for certain types of shows, right? So you can use these edit protocols, editing protocols, in order to, of course, derive also a feedback for the machine translation engineers. But that gives you, and we'll get to that later, that gives you a very limited type of information. Okay, so this is about the macro process. Oops. Now, I'll open that up here. Now, how do you ensure, or what does ensure mean? In post-editing, it is, of course, the first part of ensure always is training people well. No brainer. That is clear. How do we train people well for post-editing? In fact, we don't know so much about that yet. I believe that there is still a huge gap in this topic. Well, first of all, I'll just make a very brief comment on how I see the research landscape in post-editing. First of all, there are many things in post-editing that are going on that we don't understand yet. It is definitely cognitively a different process than human translation, and there are certain phenomena that we see in post-editing that we do not see in human translation. I'll give you some examples about that later. We don't know all too much about that yet, I believe. And then the other gap is the transfer between research and didactics, right? So even if we know about a certain type of error, for instance, that appears in post-editing, does not yet know that we know how to tackle it in training. So the first part is training. I said something, I already mentioned something about guidelines. Why would we need guidelines in post-editing? What do you think?
Save time to help people decide what to do.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. We said post-editing is about time efficiency. I mean, of course, in general, translation should... You always have a certain pressure in there, but post-editing is a mode that has been very much under surveillance from the viewpoint of time efficiency. So yes, you want to give people guidelines in order to be able to decide quickly what they should correct and what they should not correct. Maybe even how they should correct it, or to which extent, yes?
I have a question to this, and that's a really open question, I don't know the answer. Is guidelines for post-editing, is that something different from guidelines for translation?
Yes.
So if you are, because... what you're really concerned with is the kind of quality that you want in the end. And if you reach it by one way or the other, that shouldn't matter.
Mm-hmm. Yeah?
I think that the guidelines not only about the strategies, but also about the pitfalls of the text, the whole text that comes out from the machine. Let's say, to pay attention on this and that, and less to this or that.
Yeah. So I think this is partly
already... That makes sense to me,
yeah.
But for the final outcome, the guideline should be, and I think Bartu mentioned that yesterday, want only superficial post-editing, well, that results in superficial kind of translation quality. or if you want deep post-editing for high-quality translation. So I think that is the same.
Yeah.
You basically need to set the goal of what kind of translation you want.
Well, and that is a very good point. So I'll just briefly say a few words on that in general. So there are roughly two, some people sometimes have three, so roughly two levels of post-editing. I don't know how many of you have heard of that already, so I'll say a few words on that. We generally speak in post-editing, and then I'll get back to your question. Generally, in post-editing, we speak of light or rapid post-editing, or sometimes just called disting. And then mostly for post-editing. So full post-editing, that should be clear. Full post-editing is generally described as, I'll say it in simple words, correct the texts in such a way that that the outcome is comparable to a normal full human translation in terms of quality. Light or rapid post-editing, this gisting, and that is that is the point at which I'm coming back to your question. This gisting is something, so this, the idea of correcting a text minimally just as to make it understandable enough to, and now here's a question mark, I think this is actually pretty new for translation and translation studies. In that, in the magnitude of order that it is being discussed in the literature. And
what does it really mean? I mean, what when does it stop and how is it defined?
Mm-hmm. I would say, that it is not clearly defined, that is even what the Taos guidelines say. There is no true border, there is no definable border between light post-editing and full post-editing. It really depends on the viewpoint of those who write the guidelines. We will be looking at two sets of guidelines in a minute, and then you can decide for yourself. I'll just quickly look at the time. Okay, we're still good in time. And I actually have a little note on my sheet with my list of things to say, and this is a good point to sort of jump into and make a few more scientific or philosophical or basic remarks. In post-editing or in post-editing literature, this mode of light or rapid post-editing, of just minimally correcting a text, is something that is, as I already said, that is being discussed to an extent that I'm not used to, at least myself, seeing it from the viewpoint of a translation researcher, that I have not seen in standard translation literature. The usual way that translation problems are being discussed in research, or the usual way that students are trained in when you're studying translation in a translation program, is, you know, we're going to make you, it's going to hurt, right? It's going to hurt. Every comma can be a matter of debate. Every comma. And now all of a sudden, this new thing pops up, post-editing. And everything that we've been telling students, well, I myself, just for 10 years, other people for decades, right? So for me, this is not so new, right? It occurred, or this all came up still early on in my career, but, you know, think about those people that have been teaching translation for 20, 25, 30 years. All of a sudden, coming up with the idea at all that you might want to just mildly correct something that is, so to speak, or that does not match your quality standards. So you're taking something that certainly does not match your quality standards, and you're correcting it something to something that still does not match your quality standards. That is something that you have to wrap your head around, right? And then to define, you know, these very obscure levels of quality. You know, when in some cases, just to give you an example, in some cases the missing comma just doesn't matter, right? It should be there maybe due to grammatical reasons, right? But it does not change anything about the text. Still, standard way, we would mark it as an error, right, in your assignment. If it had been an assignment to you in translation class, we would mark it as an error. All of a sudden, we need to try to tell people to not correct it. That is harder than you think. If you've been trained to look at these things, and all of a sudden you should ignore them. Then the question is, what do you correct? Does that comma change the text or does it not? That is often a matter of debate, right? Some people will say, no, yeah, I get it, you know. Others will say, somehow, it's not the same two things that follow from the text. And this is certainly a reason why this border between full post-editing and rapid post-editing is so fuzzy, right? We will see that in a moment when we look at the guidelines. Then we have yet another problem. That is at least my opinion. This is not my opinion. Even full post-editing, the way it is being done nowadays, is not, even if they say, you know, correct it to an extent such that it becomes to something comparable to a human translation, I'm not sure if that is the case. If that is the case, even for many cases of full post-editing, right? When we looked at post-edits, well, let me put it in other words. People have analyzed linguistic features of human translations and of post-edited texts. And not unsurprisingly, the fully post-edited texts will exhibit different linguistic properties than human translations due to the system that's been used, due to the way texts are post-edited and so on and so forth. Well, if you say post-edited to something that is comparable to human translations, you're fine, but you will probably never end up in something that is a human translation. That is at first, this is a purely theoretical problem. I'll give you an example. German is very nominal in style, but certain statistical machine translations are very verbal in the way they translate from English to German. So they will produce more verb forms than a German translation would have. Now, if you use these texts and feed them back into your machine translation to retrain it, right? Because you have just extended your parallel corpus. You have an English translation and you have an English original and a new German translation. Then you will reproduce the linguistic features that you have, right? Your system will sort of learn a style of writing. Now, while that might not be so much of a problem, it becomes a problem in other tasks. One of the things that people have found is that for some weird reason, statistical machine translation systems seem to prefer something, when you look at translations from English to German at least, that we call cognates. Can you read that over there, or is it too low? What is a cognate? So in English, there is the word system. In German, there are multiple potential translations, System, but also, for instance, Anlage. System is the cognate of system. It is very close in terms of structure and semantics, so in terms of form and meaning, even phonetics. But Anlage isn't, of course. even though that might be correct. So system, a system is a cognate of system. Not a cognate is that case of false friends like English actual and German aktuell, where this means, well, actual, actually, and this means current, right, or recent. And there seems to be, at least for some statistical machine translation, it seems to be true that they prefer cognates. And now you get this text that has been translated from English to German, and it's full of cognates. And it's very hard, you would have to go very deeply into that product. I'll be there in a minute. And to correct, so in some cases, this is the only correct solution, right? System is not actually right in that context. But it's very hard to pinpoint such errors. So you do get a certain style in full post-edited text that is not exactly as it would be in a human translation. And then the question is, does that change anything? Can this lead to errors? Would be the first question. The other question is, what does that do to the language? Right? Does it change the way in which we use certain words? You have a question.
I'd like to defend statistical machine translation here, because I don't see any reason why a statistical machine translation would prefer cognate.
This is just what I find. Well, I mean, you know, what does defend mean? I'm not blaming statistical machine translation.
But if you claim this, I mean, you should have an explanation for this. Otherwise, I mean, that could be just an accidental observation. I mean, is there anything in how statistical machine translation systems are built that would make them prefer cognates? I don't see any point in building a statistical machine translation where they would prefer cognates. Mm-hmm.
Well,
where would that come from?
Yeah, system is a very, very frequent translational system.
Right, but then that is dependent on the corpus.
Yeah.
That's not dependent on the statistical machine translation system.
Well, it is dependent. It appears because of the way statistical machine translation systems are built. Right. If you, of course, have a very well-defined terminology that you inject at runtime, so on and so forth, you can probably get around this problem. But
right, but it's again.
It has nothing to do with cognates, basically, right?
Yeah.
Well, first of all, I want to say it has nothing to do with the way SMT systems work, but it has to do with the frequencies in the corpus that you're using. And if the word system has been translated very frequently as System in German, then this is represented in the corpus. And that, of course, is being picked up by the SMT system, which makes sense in my opinion. If that is the domain that you want to model, then you get this frequent translation suggestion. But I want to separate this, the corpus from the SMT system.
And I want to separate another thing. I spoke of linguistic features, not of errors, right? So what we might witness in such a case is actually language change through MT. Language change is a very natural process, you know, confined to a very specific LSP and a very specific domain. So I'm not talking here in terms of errors, right? But this is really just about the linguistic features that post-edited texts exhibit. There is some work by Katja Lapshinova-Kultunsky, I don't know if you know that. She has looked at the distribution of various linguistic features according to the type of system you use and so on and so forth. And that is just a very good insight. So, you know, I'm not talking about this in terms of errors. It is just important to note, right? So, I don't think there is a need to defend statistical machine translation.
But you were blaming it, so
I want to make clear. So I included the paper on this in the reading for the Moodle, right, in the Moodle reader, and also in that paper we say we're looking at it only from the viewpoint of linguistic features, not of what is wrong and what is right. I think that is a very interesting distinction to make, especially if we want to talk about translation and machine translation, because the problem is always also in the the dialogue between those two fields, that usually the mode is indeed to blame, right, one another, right? Like, you know, all machine translation, it will never get this right. That is not what I'm trying to get at here. If you felt that way, I apologize. It is not what I meant. But it is still, as I said, it is still a very new concept, both in terms of translation studies and in terms of teaching, right? It challenges a lot of the assumptions and standards that we've had for decades.
Our colleagues fear actually that post-edited texts reintroduced into translation memories. So they're going to influence the linguistic features of the text that they're going to produce in the future.
Mm-hmm.
So this is something that we have been discussed, talking about, maybe mentioned 2-3 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
It's not something that is non-existent.
Mm-hmm.
We are afraid that a lot of post-edited texts are going to change the way we translate. So they're going to change the style, even if they're going to influence the style we produce.
But the same thing was always mentioned with regard to translation memories, right? The peephole translation, not looking into the entire context, and so on. And I'm sure that it has influenced the style of those texts, so it's inevitable.
Also, it's also very often because of the source text in our style. So now we have a combination of the source text and, let's say, the post-edited raw MTL.
Plus the DM.
And I think, so if we're going to continue this very briefly, this little, so to speak, philosophical, because we just discussed this over coffee this morning, part of this fear probably is the question about the decision, right? Who makes the decision? And that is, I have no good English translation, resistance for Ogbon, probably. And that may be part of the resistance in that whole thing, right? People have the feeling, also when they posted it, so we made, we had people fill in forms, queries, no, questionnaires, that's the word, as to how happy they were doing post-editing. And they're not necessarily happy because they have this impression of, you know, having this thing loaded onto them, not really deciding about what gets translated how. But there are ways around this, also technical ways, like this Lilt style translation and stuff. But I'll leave that to a different discussion. Okay, so, as I said, this whole post-editing thing poses a challenge not only to practice, but also to translation theory and translation teaching. And there's still things, a lot of things, that I think still haven't been fully dealt with properly, whatever that means. A lot of questions that we still need to ask ourselves. But ensuring post-editing quality. Let's get back to the more concrete bits. So, I already mentioned the Moodle Reader. I put the slides, well, the slides are not very helpful, it's just basically 6 or 7 slides with graphs, graphics or tables on them. I also put in the Taos post-editing, generic post-editing guidelines from the year 2016. And I put in 5 papers, I think, from which these tables and graphs are taken, and which I think give a very nice overview into various types of post-editing research. So, Martin already asked the question, what guidelines, what do guidelines look like? There is a paper by Hu, I think it's pronounced, pronounce Hu and Cadwell from last year's EAMT conference, in which they compared different guidelines as to, well, here the first table that we see are guidelines on light pulse editing, and these guidelines were taken from various papers or documents, one of them from somebody called Mesa Law, never heard of him, Sharon O'Brien. And what is interesting to note, not for this table, but for the next table that we will see, is that those three, Flanagan, O'Brien, and Mesa Law, are rather from, our guidelines rather from an academic context, whereas Densmer and Taus are rather coming in from the practical side. We will see a little difference in the next table. But first of all, let's look at the light post editing guidelines. As to accuracy, this is a very nice dimension when you're speaking about standards or expectations. So in general, what we would expect of a light post editing, of a gisted text, is that the product communicates the same meaning as the source text. Yeah, let's just say important, and Densmer says factually accurate, but I think it all means the same thing. Good moment to ask what is this actually used for, these gisted texts. So I went on a hike last week with a friend who sends greetings to you. From the energy department, and he told me about this amazing thing that is being built at the European Union, that you can have this platform where you can pre-translate things with machine translation. I don't exactly know how it works or how it will work, and he told me about the benefits that come with it. So imagine you as the European Union are dealing with a member country, and you have a case to decide on. Some complaint that's been made, or some inquiry, and you tell them, please send me the relevant documents. Some of them may be very cooperative and will send you the exact three documents that you need, some will just send you a bunch in Polish. But you are Greek. What do you do? Well, what you could do is you could take that whole bunch, print it out, bring it to your nice translator, put it on their desk, and say, translate me the whole bunch. How long will it take? 2 months. And then you can move on to the next step. That bunch, let's say it's 10 longish documents, and maybe just one or two of them are actually relevant. And this is where this gisting or light post editing comes in. You throw it into the machine translation, that is the basic idea. You throw it into the machine translation. This is sent to a translator, and they will correct it minimally, just enough for you to be able to understand what this document is about. It might even only be the first page, right? It doesn't have to be, in some cases, maybe it doesn't have to be the full document. This is something. And this is probably one of the biggest use cases of machine translation on the web nowadays anyway, right? You have that document and you want to see, is it relevant to me and what does it actually tell me, just roughly. So the main criterion for light post editing is this text should communicate the same meaning, or maybe even better, it should be factually accurate and just about understandable. As for terminology, usually you want to have your terminology consistent. Now here's a bit of a disagreement already. It seems that Taus or Flanagan and Christensen do not actually say anything about it. O'Brien and Mesa Law say no need to research it, or no need to spend too much time researching if it's correct. Densmer, however, says be consistent at least, right? So you already see there is a certain scale. As for grammar, may not be perfect, not a big concern. No need to correct unless the information has not been fully delivered. So if that comma does make a difference, you probably need to know that nice example, let's eat grandpa, right? Or the comma, yeah. So if the comma does change the information, then put it there. If not, no need to correct it. And correct only the most obvious errors. So they seem, as for grammar, with auth, everybody seems to be on the same page. Semantics should be correct, okay? It doesn't say anything here for Brian Messano, but I think that's implicit, right? If you say that accuracy is important. Spelling, apply basic rules, right? If you have two letters that have been swapped, but it doesn't make a difference, you know, don't spend any time on it. Syntax might be unusual, can be ignored, do not change. Style, no need. Restructure, no need if the sentence is correct, no need if it can be understood. Rewrite confusing sentences. Others, very interesting, use as much raw output as possible. Brian says textual standards are not very important, very high throughput expectation, and so on and so forth. So to speak, this whole table breathes this idea of be quick, don't spend too much time. Not only correcting, but also, and that is one of the things that we'll have to somehow realize in teaching, but also in deciding whether I'm going to correct it, right? This is very hard to decide very quickly, especially if you've been trained to look very, very closely to check for errors. But it seemed, you know, they were all on the same page. Here is the table for the guidelines for the full post-editing. So, accuracy. Still pretty much the same thing. Little deviation, absolutely accurate. And that is already a question, you know, what does that mean? What is the difference between accurate for light post-editing and absolutely accurate? Could you come up with an example for that?
Yes, for instance, making sure that there is an ambiguity in the target list. Mm-hmm. Might be accurate, but still unclear. Mm-hmm.
Okay, that is one thing. You might even rank the information that is in the text, right? So you might even say, okay, somebody wants me, you know, my boss at this company in Frankfurt that tries to raid certain stocks or whatever, and they need this little newspaper bit on what happened in the latest elections in Brazil. You send them off the text to tell them this is what it is for, and you might actually not even correct mistakes that basically concern how somebody commented on the election, but you might want to just go into that part where the actual results are discussed, right? What does it mean? Who's going to be the next president, right? But here, in the full post-editing, you want to be absolutely accurate for every piece of information that is in there. Terminology should, of course, be correct. That's why it says consistent and appropriate. Grammar should be correct, accurate, correct, correct. The same, semantics, correct, 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 correct. Punctuation, correct, apply basic rules. Okay, that is interesting again. That is a difference, right? At least in how we would usually grade an assignment, a translation assignment at university. You don't want just the basic rules, you want it to be, you know, like really good. Spelling, apply basic rules. Densmer says correct. Syntax, normal, correct. Make modifications is important. Practices for the target language. And here comes the biggest difference between the one on the left and on the very left and the very right, and the three in the middle. So practice on the open part, academic on the middle part. Style. Tao says fine, whatever fine means. Denso says consistent, appropriate, and fluent. And all the academic works, and not only here, this is what I usually read when I read about post-editing research. All the academic works say, ignore stylistic and textual problems or not important. Are we still talking about the same type of full post-editing? Not so sure. Certainly not.
And then,
yes?
That would be the point where we jump from a post-editing task to a human translation task. I mean, if I have to spend so much time changing style, probably we are in one of those cases where it was not worth applying post-editing.
But that is a very good, I mean, first of all, that is a very good point. But if you say post-editing will be, or machine translation will in future always be a part, so you will always be doing post-editing in future as a translation, we shouldn't make a difference between
If that's the case, then...
That is something you said yesterday. That is something you said yesterday. You said, forget about translation memories, you will be doing post-editing in 5 years' time or whatever. Most of the time.
Yeah, I think that's true. But so, as we are now, and we have to draw a line between human translation from scratch, or with translation memories, or post-editing with, of course, humans involved, fixes, and so on. Style will be one of those parameters that we used to say. If it's good enough, or if it's kind of, if it's not wrong, save the time I'm asking you to save, there. Because this is post-editing, this is not human translation from scratch.
So, I'll just make one more comment and then pass on that to you. So, good enough is again a very interesting concept that has been introduced, that is something that I read frequently in NLP or machine translation, so natural language processing machine. It is not a term that I know from translation studies. That's what I'm, you know, hinting at all the time. This is where we clash. But what do you think about post-editing and style? If I take your argument from yesterday that we will be doing a lot of post-editing in the future, then we will have to rethink this this idea of, you know, for we maybe need more levels of more quality levels of post-editing, right? Like an intermediate level, or I mean, you already said, you know, the question is the purpose. Will it be just circulated internally? Will it be just for information internally? Will it be to make a decision on what is relevant, or do you want to publish it? And then if you want to publish it, I was actually going to say that towards the end, but thanks for bringing this up. And if you want to publish it, there's also, of course, different types of publication. A tourism leaflet with what can happen. But if you're selling chemicals, you might want to make sure that, as you said, you know, Denso, you might want to use the Denso set of rules, right? But this is basically, or what that table highlights is that, as I said when I spoke about rapid and full post-editing, is that those two concepts are extremely fuzzy, right? They're very fuzzy at the borders, and even their cores are not fully clear. Okay, now, or anyone want to add something to that? No. Okay. Bartok, how do you think?
Tomorrow I will try to show a list of check, or let's say checklists, that you could apply in order to avoid that fussiness between high posterity or full posterity. Mm-hmm. Because it's true that from the human point of view, we need to react to errors. Mm-hmm. So there is a lot of training there to say, okay, this is not the case that I should be fixing this. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean,
so
I just,
we always aim for accurate, mm-hmm. accurateness, if you can mm-hmm. say that. That's very important. Mm-hmm. And then, on top of that, let's put punctuation, let's put grammar, let's put style. And style, as I said, it's the one that I will put at the top. Mm-hmm. Because that will be the dividing point between why am I posting it in this interpretation? If I'm working so much, I mean, maybe we'll have been more productive to translate from scratch.
Mm-hmm. Next task could be outsourced to achieve. Which of the tasks? Or which of the labs, so you have to perform certain tasks, right?
Yes.
What of these things that you say could be outsourced to the machine? Terminology check. Existing terminology.
Yeah, that can be
what else? So this is
the rest is for human, of course. And style is, yeah.
Okay, style is untouchable.
Yeah. But actually, yeah, from what you say, we will see that machines can also help to do a pre-check of the output we get before we get into humans.
Exactly. Type of potential errors. So that fits in well with your questions. So now we're at the point where you had great guidelines that were tailored to your need and to your target audience and so on and so forth, right? So do you need to correct style or do you not need to correct style? You've posted it in your text and now you want to check, you want to know how well the whole process went. You know, what is the quality level that I reached? Assuming here at this point you wanted to get everything as correct as possible, not speaking about style but everything else, how do you rate it? So your question was very interesting. What can be done by machines? So here is an error classification for translations that was devised within machine translation, right? For the purpose of machine translation. And what do you notice about it? Is there anything you think that is missing? So think or imagine you wanted to apply this to your post-edited text, this classification. What would you gain out of it? What do you think would be missing? That is exactly the point here. The other point is that these are things that are easily detectable automatically, most of them, right? It says here style, but it is under incorrect words. So I guess what it means is maybe an expression that is, you know, in terms of register, does not fit here or whatever. There are techniques to automatically post-edit your text. What is the abbreviation was?
APE.
APE, yes, APE. I was thinking of MTAG, but I think that's just longer. One of those nice acronyms. So there are certain errors that can be post-edited automatically, especially when you have a good idea of what the weaknesses of the system are. So you can automatically highlight or even correct potential errors. why am I showing this, even though, I mean, this is a bit of a, I'm cheating here a little, right? Because I'm showing you a machine translation classification for errors, but what you said is exactly what I wanted to get at, that the perspective, you know, speaking of approaching this whole process and the quality assurance of post-editing has for a long time been done on this level, so to speak, also in the research. So it's very easy to rate your quality when, you know, by calculating the number of terminological errors that you have, by calculating the number of grammatical errors that you have, typos that are in there, punctuation that has been missing, and so on and so forth. But the thing that has only recently, I hope this is not too small to be read, that has only recently shifted more into focus in post-editing research also in general, is that whole question, or are those whole dimensions that we usually know from translation studies, right? For instance, the whole style and register. So this is an error classification or an evaluation classification by Joke Dimes in Ghent. So for instance, the whole style and register department here, right? We already said we might not actually want to look at style, but she has it in here as a potential dimension along which to rate the outcome of your post-editing. We have things like coherence, logical problems, missing info, inconsistency, also for instance on the terminological level. Plus, we have the whole adequacy register here. And here you will find a lot of terms that, like explicitation, or meaning shift, or deletion, that actually come from translation studies. And to me, this is a very interesting, very important point, because there are services that offer. I know that from the institute that I used to work at before, that offer evaluation of your translation or of your post-edited text. But they do it, of course, because it's so easily done, rather by a schema like this, because this is what can be done automatically. What is much harder and very time-consuming, of course, is to evaluate some or all of these dimensions.
Oh, wait a minute.
Yes.
What can be done automatic on the previous slide?
Well, probably things like punctuation, for instance. Punctuation errors you can detect automatically. You could, at least some of the, like if I think about the more advanced grammar checkers, they can, well, not correct, but evaluate things like word order, long distance dependencies. They probably cannot detect incorrect disambiguation because you have to look at your at the source text. Incorrect forms, I would guess this is all, this includes typos or for instance wrong what's the English word?
Agreement,
yes, thanks, wrong agreement. So there are a few things that can be done automatically here, but not all of them. But what is even harder, as I said, is to go and assess the quality of your post-editing along these dimensions. There are a few attempts at trying to find measures in order to assess that type of quality. And one of the things that we try, because of course also when you assess the quality of your post-edited text, I mean, if the whole thing is about time efficiency and you don't want to be very quick at post-editing but then spend a month doing the QA, right? But as you said, textual criteria are something that are very hard to assess. One of the problems in general in translation is the question of consistency, terminological consistency, for instance. How could you evaluate that? You could, of course, have a machine trying to detect your terminological variation, the variance you used. Is it always an error? We don't know. But how do you quantify a problem like this, like a terminological, your terminological consistency? One of the things, or the thing that I did with my PhD student, was we had students, we had little pieces of texts, very simple, actually on a very simple technical level. One was a dishwasher manual, and the other was a package leaflet for medication. And we asked them to translate that bit, to lightly post-edit another bit, and to fully post-edit a third bit. We discarded the light post-edits for this kind of study because, well, in the guidelines, it doesn't necessarily say something like make sure the terminology is consistent. But we compared the human translations and the full post-edits as to the level of terminological variation they would exhibit, right? Going back to this question of linguistic features of post-edited versus human translated texts. Here, taken from the dishwasher text, part of the problem is that, so we were using, in that case, Google Translate, and German has at least three variants for dishwasher, which are Spülmaschine, Geschirrspülmaschine, and Geschirrspüler. And at least to German standards, you would expect all of these to be exactly just one form, right? Exactly just one term. Whereas, of course, in other languages like Spanish, variation is not unusual or even expected, right? So this is really just English to German. So Google Translate, out of five instances of one of the texts where dishwasher was mentioned, would produce Spülmaschine twice, Geschirrspülmaschine twice, and Geschirrspüler once. We gave people the source text and the raw machine translation output, and we gave them a set of full post-editing guidelines, having everything in there. So, you know, not saying specifically go for the terminology, but try to correct the grammar as much as possible. To take out the errors at least. What you saw before on the table. Try to be correct as for the information, fluent enough, and make your terminology consistent. So what happened? Some people were a little better at making it consistent than others. Some people forgot about it totally, completely, even though it was in the guidelines. And this was very interesting, a little side note, because this is something that we did not see in the monolingual post-editing. So when we asked people to do a monolingual post-editing of these texts, making terminology consistent was not a problem at all. But at that moment where you presented them with the source text and the raw machine translation, a totally different type of error started to come up to appear. Now, how do you measure that? One of the problems we had was we didn't tell people what the preferred term should be. They could decide. And then, of course, it is not one person, but it is across texts. So what we did was we invented categories for the various potential translations. If you used Geschirrspülmaschine most of the time, and the other variant just once or twice, then this would fall into the category preferred translation, and that into category synonym one, right? If you did something like that, then you would have preferred translation twice, it twice produces synonymous translations and one first synonymous variant and once the second synonymous variant. This way, we were able to give, to calculate across texts and across participants the probability of how often they would produce, so to speak, a preferred translation of the term, so to correct it into their own preferred variant, or to produce the first synonymous translation or the second. When you do that with a little bit of calculation, with a measure taken actually from from machine translation, you can calculate the level of variation for a certain term across all of the post-edited texts. Right? It seems a little complex, that whole calculation, but it helps us to calculate a variation of terms across all the post-edited texts. So what you see here are the terms that appeared: vaccine, measles, varicella, chickenpox. Very interesting. A variation in the English text, but in all German human translations, no variation at all. Right? There seems to be some sort of standard that seems to be at work there. Then, okay, protafane is not actually a term, it's a name. Anti-cancer medicine, dishwasher in one text, dishwasher in the second text, rinse aid, filter, and compass upper, filter assembly. So here is a column for variation within the machine translation, here for the full post edit, and here for the human translation. What do you see? What is better, Martin, if I may ask you? Which one is better in terms of variation?
I didn't follow it.
Okay. So in defense, so to speak, for machine translation is actually better, right? That is the good part about it. So humans vary in more instances, but at the same time, when machine translation starts to vary, but this is just about Google Translate in that sense, so the system or that workflow that you are now assessing, right? Using Google Translate, doing this full post-edit. So when it starts varying, then you know, the variation is higher. The other interesting point here is that in the full post-editing, people will vary at the same points as the machine translation. Right? If you look at it from a statistical viewpoint, you can see, so this here now in a line drawing, which is not actually the best way to visualize it, that has been mentioned a number of times. But if you see, so to speak, if you follow that path, which is not exactly a path, of variation, then you will see that full post-editing and machine translation are very close, but human translation has its very own pattern of variation. And that relates back to something that I said at the beginning. When you read the title, Ensuring Post-Editing Quality, you probably expected me to come up with, you know, a set of guidelines that you should always use. Of course, always adapt to your current use case, and then you'll be happy with it. Practice it a little bit, and you'll be done. But my... okay, I'll comment that in a minute. But my message is, we don't actually know so much about it right now. Still, I believe, how to ensure post-editing quality, whatever we define as quality at that point. This is another nice graph by Joke Dimes, same study as the table that I showed you. You will see that, so the light ones are errors in post-editing that were not caused by machine translations, and errors in post-editing that were caused by machine translation. So somehow people seem to fail to be able to correct certain errors in machine translation. What are the reasons? Probably lack of training, lack of, how should you say, you're not confronted with the task probably very often during your studies or maybe your early work, but also a lack of knowledge on the side of research and didactics and learning. There are many processes happening in this post-editing that we don't understand very well. There is a whole sort of line of studies that looks into the differences between human translation and post-editing from a cognitive point of view. So people are followed, their gaze is followed when they post-edit. Their key logs are tracked, and you can see what type, how they approach the text. So how they approach it on a macro level. So what do? They consult the source text very often or not at all? Do they make a second correction cycle and so on and so forth? And then of course, how do they deal with certain types of errors or what? So what do they focus on? Do they focus on words? Do they look at punctuation at all? Do they go through the text as a whole, something that you mentioned, Zoran? You know, do they see the text as a text? Or do they, is it something that should be like called people, translation or correction, right? You always only look at the little segment. What is happening there? What causes this influence of machine translation of on post-editing? Now, I think there are a lot of open questions when it comes to this topic of ensuring post-editing quality, but at the same time, my hope was that if I present you with these problems and questions, that you might actually find strategies for yourself when you work with this. You might actually, at least in the beginning, I mean later on of course, when you're working on big volumes and with time pressure and so on and so forth, that you try to monitor yourself a little on how to go about this. If there is anything that I can recommend to you, it's look at the Taos post-editing guidelines. I could have given myself an easy job and more or less present to you the Taos post-editing guidelines, right? There is everything in there that you need to know and that we know by now. Very generic guidelines and recommendations as to what to look out for depending on the type of job you're doing, right? Workflow questions with regard to whether you are a small company or whether you are a big company with a huge, you know, translation department and so on and so forth. But looking at the sort of zooming in onto the individual, so onto you, there are still a lot of questions to be asked or answered, and maybe you will find at least some answers for your very self when practicing post-editing with Bhakti. So that's it from me. I'm happy for any questions or comments. Yes?
So I think errors introduced by the post-editors. We are correct on some of them.
Mm-hmm.
Like in the translators revise when they revise translations, sometimes they introduce errors instead of correcting them. Has anyone had a look at this?
I'm not aware of it, I must say. Well, probably, I mean, it's here in the paper by Joko Dams, but I'm not aware that it has been looked at very intensely.
Also,
yes.
I think you mentioned the perplexity coefficient 2.5. So I suppose that the aim is 1, right? If the error appears just as.
That is a very good question, and it's very good that you are coming up with it.
Yes, and what would be actually, are there any recommendations? How much would you
That's a very good question. I'm very glad you're asking that. I'm sure I have it here on my paper, but I didn't look at it anymore. Because actually, in the paper where we're describing that, we're saying one is not the aim, right? There are certain reasons why it might actually vary. It might be due to linguistic reasons, It might be due to reasons of style, text type, and so on and so forth. As I mentioned, in Spanish, variation for terminology is actually not uncommon or even expected. So in a Spanish text, you might actually want to say if there's too much of the number one, that is not good. And then it also depends on the text type. So these were technical texts where you would want to have very consistent terminology. But think of a popular scientific text where too much consistency is boring, right? So, yeah, if I've given the impression that one is the aim that we have, then I need to correct this.
No, I suppose that this kind of technical text comes on the specific terminology.
Yeah, in that case,
so,
not even then, because, for instance, you might have cases in the translation from English to German where you might, or from German to English rather, where you might want to verbalize things that are nominal in German, right? For instance, upper filter assembly, that is very nominal, unusual for English. So something like assembly in German might often become a verb, assemble this and that in English.
Is there any data on what is acceptable?
This is very recent, and I don't know if people have. I don't know if one could do that for a large number of texts and say this number is acceptable. You could probably give a range, right? Here, the upper bound is 5, right, of the value. You probably wouldn't want to have the variation value of 5 in a technical text, but maybe 1.7 is okay. So, but it's very hard to pinpoint it. This is mainly, this idea of this coefficient is a reply to this problem or an attempt at going at the problem that you mentioned, Zoran, that on this, so for instance, quality of estimations, human quality estimation for machine translation, we go off and break sentences. Not only, but often. And, you know, then you lose the whole text level. And this is at least one dimension, one of the many on a text level, right? One that is, that can be easily operationalized. Okay, further questions, comments? Who has now completely been discouraged from facility? No one. That is good. That was certainly not my goal. No, I'm one of those kinds of people who dreams of a Star Trek type translation computer. So, if you all lose your jobs, maybe it's not as bad as no, just joking. Okay. Thanks for listening. And yeah, if you have any further questions, feel free to address me.